Now, what we try to do today is learn the basics of the encoder, then follow it up with the more practical version, namely the priority encoder. Now, let me try to share my PDF. So can you see the PDF now, all of you? Hello, you can see the video? You can see the PDF?
Yes sir.
So please respond. Now, what is this encoder? Encoder is a combination logic module that assigns a unique output code or a binary number for each input signal applied to the device. Now, see, there is a minimum number of bits that one should devote for encoding a number of inputs. So suppose there are 10 inputs, so you require a minimum number of 4-bit output. That means 10 inputs means 2 to the power 4 is 16. And say 2 to the power p greater than or equal to 10, then p is the least number so that this inequality is satisfied. Okay, so for an encoder with n inputs, the number of output bits s must satisfy this inequality, namely 2 to the power s is greater than or equal to n, or s is greater than or equal to log 2 n. So for example, to encode 10 decimal digits distinctly, one requires at least s equal to 4 bits. Okay, now, sorry for that interruption. So the circuit structure, let me show you. We start from the most stringently specified encoder. What do you mean by most stringently? You see that the circuit structures for encoders with mutually exclusive inputs. Okay, so example is that we want to design an encoder for input lines. Sorry, what is the question? Okay, so we want to design an encoder for input lines if one and only one input is active at any point of time. Okay, this is, you can say, somewhat unusual. That means it is a very stringent operation. Okay, we do not allow anything above a single input being active at any point of time. Okay, so x3, x2, x1, x0 are there. Okay, let us say we are talking about active high input encoder. That means in order to be asserted, say either x3 or x2 or x1 or x0, one of them must be at logic 1. Okay, so we want to design such an encoder for 4 input lines. Yeah. Question.
Could please zoom in the PDF a little bit.
Okay. Now it is visible. I think the maximum I've done. Is it visible now?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, please point out any mistake I have committed. Okay. So encoder is a combination logic module. It does the converse operation. Okay. The last day we studied about decoder, where at any point of time, one and only one output must be active. Okay. That means we want to decode or recognize a particular input combination. Here the job is converse. Why we say so is that at any point of time, one and only one input will be encoded. That means the output word that we shall get will correspond to one and only one input. Okay. For decoder, it is one and only one output that is active. In the case of encoder, we shall encode one and only one input. Okay, that means if simultaneously more than one input will be say active, we have to encode only one input. Now, which one input we shall take, that we should come to later. For the time being, let us satisfy ourselves with the criterion that only one input will be encoded. Okay. But we start with the design of an encoder, which is a bit impractical. Why we call it to be impractical is that at any point of time, we say that one of the four inputs will be active, not more than one. Also, it is not the case that none of the inputs will be, say, inactive. So that means at any point of time, either x0 or x1 or x2 or x3 are active. So these are the all four possible cases. Okay. Then what will be what the truth table of such an encoder will look like? That means we want to derive the circuit structure. Okay. So what is the circuit structure that will result if we leave such a stringent specification? So this is the truth table. Note the truth table. What we write? See, it is an active high encoder for simplicity. That means if x0 is at logic 1, it means that the input x1 is asserted. It is active. And we have to get the corresponding encoded bit for input x0. For simplicity, again, see x0, x1, x2, and x3 have got the four subscripts. Okay, the subscripts can be 0, 1, 2, 3. For simplicity, we say that the output word of the encoder will correspond to the binary equivalent of the subscript. That means 0 means 0, 0. A1 is the more significant bit, A0 is the less significant bit. X1, 1 means this is 0, this is 1. X2 means A1 is 1, A0 is 0. That means when X2 is high, you say that here. So 0, 1, 0, 0. This is the case, 1, 0. And lastly, X3, its binary word is 1, 1. So when 1 followed by 000, we get this is the output. So you see that only four input combinations we are asked to take care of. That is this second row, 0001, when only x0 is active, no others. Okay. And the output is 00. Secondly, look at the third row. That means 0010. What does it mean? It means that only x1 is activated, but no other three inputs. So then the output word that will result is 01. Thirdly, you see that, look at this eighth row, row 8, where, sorry, not that, 0100, this one. So when only x2 is active, but not the other three, so the output word resulting is 10. And lastly, 1 followed by 000, so this is a 1. So that means second row, third row, fifth row, and the ninth row. These are the rows that we have to take care of, but no others. So that means if we know for sure that the other input combinations are never going to happen, then we can safely put the output bits to be don't care. X6, we write. Okay, you know that you have learned in your earlier classes that the presence of don't cares or the X's will remarkably make it simpler, will lead to simpler circuit. More is the number of don't cares. Okay, you can simplify the circuit more. Okay, so here we have got so many don't cares. You see that the outputs are specified, clearly specified in only four input combinations, 00, 01, 10, and 11. The rest, in all other cases, A1 and A0 happen to be don't care. And that lends itself to a remarkably simple realization of A1 and A0 in terms of X3, X2, X10. So in terms of Boolean functions, you see that these are the two output columns, these are the four input columns, and each of the output function, each of the output variable A1 or A0 is a function of the four Boolean variables, namely X3, X2, X1 and X0. So if we are supposed to, see, we are supposed to implement the encoder outputs, that means A1 and A0 in terms of gates, combinational gates. This is a combinational function. That means A1 and A0 are immediately defined in terms of X3, X2, X1, X0. These are not sequential circuits. Okay, sequential circuit we shall study afterward. So it is a purely combinational circuit. That means A1 is a function of these four input variables, namely X3, X2, X1, X0. A0 is likewise. So what we do, we draw the Carnot map of X2. Sorry, we draw the Carnot map of A1 and A0. This left one is the A1. You see that only in four case, namely for For x1, x0 becoming 0, 0, x2, x3, x2 becoming 0, 1, we get a definite value. Here also definite value. Here also definite value. So in the remaining 12 cells, in the remaining 12 squares, we have only x, right? Nothing else. Okay. And similarly. Hello? Hello? Orpita, hello? পরে কথা বলবো, আমি ক্লাস নিচ্ছি, পরে কথা বলবো। হ্যাঁ আমি তোমাকে পরে, ওকে ওকে, শিওর শিওর শিওর, থ্যাংক ইউ থ্যাংক ইউ, আমি থ্যাংক ইউ, ঠিক আছে, ওকে থ্যাংক ইউ, ওকে সরি, সো সরি ফর দ্যাট ইন্টারাকশন। সো এ ওয়ান, দিস ইজ দ্য কার্নু ম্যাপ অফ এ ওয়ান অ্যান্ড দিস ইজ দ্য কার্নু ম্যাপ অফ এ জিরো। বোথ অফ দ্য ফাংশনস এ ওয়ান অ্যান্ড এ জিরো হ্যাপেন টু বি আ ফোর ভেরিয়েবল বুলিয়ান ফাংশন। সো হিয়ার ইউ গেট এ ওয়ান টু বি দ্য বুলিয়ান অর অফ এক্স টু অ্যান্ড এক্স থ্রি, A0 to be the Boolean word of x1 and x3. Okay, so this is the circuit for the encoder. You see that we require only two number of two input OR gates, as simple as possible. Okay, but let me tell you, this I give you as a small home task. Tomorrow you give me the answer. Suppose you make the output, you make the specification a bit less stringent. That means you allow x0 to x1 multiple number of inputs to be active, right? You allow them, but the specification is that a definite code will be outputted provided only when a single input is activated. Take it as a home task, all of you. I shall ask this question tomorrow. That means this is a very stringent specification and a bit impractical. That means we want, look at the specification, if one and only one input is active at any point of time. That means at any point of time, so you are sampling the analog clocks at a particular instant, when we are interested in sampling the input as well as the output, it should be the case that only one of the four inputs should be active, as stringent as that, and the output should be corresponding to the input code of that particular input, right? So there can be only four situations. One situation is that only x0 is activated, that is shown by the second input, where you have got definite output value, right? Second input combination is that you have got corresponding to the third row, where only one x1 is activated, the remaining three are silent, they are deactivated, they are deasserted, and a1, a0 corresponds to the input code for x1. Clear? The third input combination possible is 0100. Only x2 is asserted, the remaining three are silent, they are not activated. So the output results corresponds to the input code, the binary code of x2. And the fourth possible combination is this 1000. So these four are only possible, none others are possible, right? So then what we do, we get a1 and a0, we require only two number of two input OR gates. Now if we try to relax the constraint, this is the most constrained input condition. Let me tell you, this is the most constrained input condition for a four input encoder. Now if you want to relax the constraint, what you can say, well, I am allowing either a single input being activated or more than one being activated, but the output will not be of interest to us. The output that will be allowed is that only when a single input is activated, not more than that. So this will be a bit relaxed constant. You try to design the circuit. Okay, that means the statement will be like that. We design an encoder for four input lines. If we allow one or more inputs to be activated at any point of time, but the output that will be resulting will be a definite output when only one input will be activated. So that means when x0, only x0 is there, we get the output. Only x1 is there, we get the output. Only x2 is there, we get the output. Only x2, right? And now, for the remaining outputs, let us say we have a particular output, say 0, 0, right? So lead you to the answer. The answer is that two output bits will not suffice because we want a fifth condition, right? Here there are four conditions: only x0 is true, only x1 is true, only x2 is true, or only x3. Now in the train there will be five conditions: only x0 is true, only x1 is true, x2. The fifth condition will be the all the remaining cases, and for that the output, let us say, is so some definite output. So some definite output means we require five distinct outputs. So five distinct outputs means we require a third bit. So let then A2, A1, A0 will be three bits. Clear? Say A2 and A1, A0 will be all zero. Okay. And say if we have only X0, so make A2 to be 1, then 0, 0. Then X1, make A2 to be 1, and then 0, 1. X2 is there, only X2, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1. Clear? So we require five distinct outputs. So for that, you design the circuit. Tomorrow, you tell what is the circuit. Okay. If not, I will tell you the answer. Now, let us go over to this condition. That means octal to binary encoder. This is a bit practical circuit, but still not very practical. Why? We shall discuss. So octal to binary encoder means what? There are eight inputs, my dear. D0, I have not shown. Why? You will tell me the answer. Only I am showing D1, D2, D3, D4, D5, D6, D7. There is no priority amongst them. All are equally important. Okay. And what are the outputs? We require three outputs. So here also we shall tacitly assume that one and only one input will be active at any point of time. Right? Now, what will be the output corresponding to only D0 being activated? D0 is an input, but see that this is the circuit. In the circuit, there is no place for D0, but the complete output is there, A2, A1, A0, right? So the circuit will involve the remaining seven inputs, not D0, but D0 is an important input. And the output code corresponding to D0 is 0, 0, 0. So when that can happen, anyone? That means I want when D0 is activated, this output to be resulting. But in the circuit structure, D0 is not there. So how can we get A2, A1, A0 to be 0, 0, 0? Will it happen? Anyone? Who can answer? Anyone?
When all others are...
call you by name, say, Abhishek, Abhishek is there. Abhishek Mohanty? Hello? Can you answer? Anyone?
Like, if you want yes. D0, D1 to D7 is already 0, right? Only D0 exactly. Will be 1. So if all of it is 0, then all the, I guess, these are OR gates, right? So they'll
okay.
get
very good, 0. Very good. Thank you. That was Abhishek. No. So that means these 7 inputs, if they are deactive, that means they are not asserting, then this should be 0, all 0. So if the all seven inputs are zero, definitely A2, A1, A0 will result to be 0, 0. And that will correspond to the code for D0. Even though D0 is not explicitly taken care of in the circuit, I mean, it is not present in the circuit, but its presence is felt. Even though D0 is not present in the circuit, all of you can see the, drawing, na? All of you can see?
So that yes, means,
yes yeah. sir.
So if
yes,
all sir. The seven inputs are inactive, even then we'll get the output code corresponding to D0. That means 0, 0, 0, right? Otherwise, what will happen? You see that, see from the truth table itself, from the truth table, by inspecting the truth table, you can directly come at the output. Okay, because you see that you require a 7-variable Carnot map. That is impossible. Okay, it is impossible to draw a 7-variable Carnot map. You can draw up to 6-variable. For 7-variable and upwards, you require a Quine-McCluskey tabulation minimization technique. Okay, so here you see, just by inspecting the okay, so by inspecting this function table or the truth table of the octal to binary encoder, we can get at the output equation. Right. But the most formal technique will be to take care of inspection is error prone. So that's why in order to have a what you call computer implementable method, we take care of either Carnot map or Quine-McCluskey, the tabulation technique, okay, table-driven procedure. Here you see that A2 can be directly written as the Boolean OR of D4, D5, D6, D7, okay, A2, D4, D5. And looking at the second output table, I can see that A1 will be true when D2 is true or D3 is true or D6 is true or D7. So that means A1 is the corresponds to the logical sum of the four variables D2, D3, D6, D7. And lastly, A0 is the logical sum of the input variables, namely D1, D3, D5, and D7. Clear? So we get the circuit structure. It consists of nothing but three number of four input OR gates. Okay, so 7432 is a two input OR gate. Okay, it is a quad two input OR gate, right? 7432, all of you know that this particular 14-bit dual inline package consists of four number of two input OR gates. So we require three of them, because four input OR gate may not be available in reality. So you have to use three number of two input OR gates. Clear? That's how you can realize a four input OR gate. Okay, so in order to have three distinct four input OR gates, we require 3 × 3, 9 number of two input OR gates. So the logic circuit which we show, mind you have to mention whether I am taking the help of Activi inputs, Activi outputs. So it is a question, if nothing is mentioned, you can take the inputs to be Activi and also the outputs to be Activi. So it is clearly a case of Activi inputs, and similarly the inputs will also be Activi. But definitely for encoder, we shall go to active low input, active low input and active low output. And there, mostly in practice, you will find that commercially available chips, always deal with active low inputs or active low outputs. There is a reason, I think it has been discussed in class. That means in TTL logic, logic low is more important than logic high. That means if there is a snap, if a wire is disconnected and you are not aware of that, that any disconnected input can also pretend to be a logic 1 input. But logic 0 means definitely it is the result of some circuit condition. So logic low input, logic low output will be of higher importance than logic high input and logic high output. Clear? Okay. Because it means that the circuit is operating correctly. Means electrical defects are less when you are dealing with, if we get the perfect output for active low condition or perfect input for active low condition, then actually the circuit is operating electrically correct. There is no electrical fault. But high means that there is a probability that it is the result of some circuit disconnection. Okay, we'll discuss more of this in future also. So for the time being, octal to binary encoder for active high output means it's a very simple structure. It consists of three number of four input OR gates. This is the result. And also, even though D0 is not involved in the circuit structure, but still we get the code corresponding to D0, which results when all of the remaining seven are inactive. So here also a stringent condition: at any point of time, one of the eight inputs must be active. Okay, clear? Now let us go over to decimal to BCD encoder. This is an example where you see that we need to encode only 10 number of inputs, not more than that. Okay, so that means if you look at the equation, how many bits will require? AC is greater than or equal to log 2 n, so n is 10 here. So, and log 2 10 means this is 3 point something, but between 3 and 4. So the minimum number of bits should be 4. That's why we require to encode 10 number of inputs, we require at least 4 inputs, and we deal with the 4 inputs. Here also what we do, even though there are 10 inputs D0 to D9, but the circuit structure has only 9 inputs, namely D1 to D9. So there is no explicit input for a decimal 0. So the BCD coded decimal, binary coded decimal BCD output is all 0 when the decimal inputs 1 to 9 are 0. So that means the presence of D0 is implied by the absence of D1 to D9. Okay. So that's why if all of the 9 inputs are inactive, namely at logic 0 condition, then we get the code for D0, namely this is 0, this is 0, this is 0, and 0. All 4 output bits are 0. And also you can get a order of significance to A3, A2, A1, A0 is that A3 is of the highest, most significant bit, A0 is the least significant bit. So this is a 4-bit BCD output. Okay, and you can also write, designing a circuit means we are going from specification to design. Okay, specification means we start with an output. Is the truth table is the specification. We need to get the circuit structure. This is the implementation. So this is the specification, this is the implementation. So we are going from specification to implementation. That is the design. Okay, you understand the difference between design and analysis. Design means that the input-output specification is there and your job is to arrive at the circuit structure which will implement the specification. So this is the specification given in the form of a truth table because it is a purely combinational circuit. For a sequential circuit, it will be a state table. Okay. For a combinational circuit, it is a pure simple truth table or function table, and our job is to arrive at the implementation. That means the is the interconnection of gates, okay, such that the outputs are clearly defined in terms of the inputs, which is specified by the specification, namely truth table. Okay, so here A3, for example, we can just inspect and get the. So you can write A3 equal to D8 or with D9. These are the clearly 10 inputs. Similarly, A2 is what? It is a Boolean OR of D4 or D5 or D6 or D7, right? So we write it like this. Similarly, A1 is for the Boolean OR of D2 or and D3 and D6 and D7. And finally, A0, it is the logical sum of, see, it is not the arithmetic sum. That's why I iteratively tell you, do not get bored, because why I tell you, it is not arithmetic sum. Although we are writing the plus symbol, we are not doing any arithmetic sum. We are doing the logical sum, okay, right? In the framework of Boolean algebra, okay? So Boolean algebra, what is that? The clear and strict definition is that it's a lattice, okay? The definition of Boolean algebra is that it is a complemented, bounded lattice, okay? And it is also characterized by the fact that there is a distribution of OR over AND, distribution of AND over OR. So these things, I believe, all have been discussed in the earlier class. Okay, but I wish to remind you of the basic tenets of Boolean algebra, because the entire digital electronics is based on the set theory and the Boolean algebra concepts, the tenets. Okay, the basic postulates, axioms, and theorems. Okay, right. We'll discuss whenever time will come. So A3, A2, A1, A0. These are the four outputs of the decimal to BCD encoder. For decimal to BCD encoder, this is a 10 input and 4 output circuit. It's a multiple input, multiple output circuit. And here we are taking care of what you call as the active high inputs and active high outputs. If nothing is mentioned, we tacitly assume that it is active high input, active high output. Others we shall mention. And in fact, in this particular topic, we'll make use of active low input, active low output also, right? Clear? Any doubt? Now we'll take a bit practical side. This is a priority encoder. So what is that? See, our circuits will fail if at any point of time we have got more than one input to be activated. So both D0 and D1, D1 and D2 are activated, what will be the circuit? Then it can lead to some code will result which may not be actual code. Okay, that you can just see. So if both D2 and D3 are active, then we'll get A1 to be 0, right? And D3 to be 0, something like that. So that you can find that it may correspond to what? If A2 and, sorry, for example, if D2 and D3 both are active, then what is the code you get? You get 1-1, right? 0-0, but 1-1 corresponds to what? 1-1 corresponds to D3. So you can question, well, I have got D2 to be active, so what about D2? So if multiple number of inputs are there, we do not know what the code corresponds to. But if we have a structural, what is called priority encoder, we know what is the design principle, then we can say, yes, it is D3, because D3 has got the higher subscript compared to D2. Okay, so how do we define a priority encoder? Encoder seen so far operate correctly if one and only one input is high or active at any given time. In practice, however, two or more inputs may be asserted at the same point of time. Say, some practical condition can be such that in computer system, you have got more number of active inputs. So one can be a CD-ROM drive, one can be a memory module, one can be a polled input. Suppose that means polled input means that at any point of time, the processor, the microprocessor or the CPU will stop to poll, that means to ask whether you shall send me data or whether you shall send me data. And there is a polling. Okay, there is a looking for the input conditions, which one of them, which one wants to send data. Now, if it so happens that in the absence of arbitration, that this number of input devices are there, all of them want to provide data to the CPU or the microprocessor, and all of them in burst mode start sending data, then it will be a problem for the CPU to either arbitrate or find out who is actually sending the data. So there should be a scheme. There should be a scheme by which we can say that if it is a situation that more number of inputs are active, the CPU will only accept one of them. And for that, the signal will be sent that now you will send me data, no one else. So people will understand, and the others will stop. They will remain silent. The one that is given the access will send the data. So that is called arbitration. So priority encoder has come from the practical need. Okay. So what does a priority encoder do? A priority encoder allows multiple input lines to be active. It allows. It is a less stringent condition. And sends out the binary value of the subscript of the input line with the highest priority. So it is a question of fixed priority. To simplify the design, highest priority is assigned to the highest subscript, the next to highest subscript to the second highest subscript, and so on. Okay, that means we look at the index or the subscript of the input. So for example, here you see one example I have given you. We just read the statement. So there are four inputs. Okay. There are four inputs. Okay, just see. Right. Okay, so here you see there are four inputs, D0, D1, D2, D3. So obviously D3 has got the highest subscript, D0 has got the lowest subscript. Now, how many output bits you will require? Definitely for encoding, four number inputs, you will require only two. But for priority encoder, we keep a third output. That is called a valid bit indicator. Okay. Apart from outputs A and B, a third output B or valid bit indicator is set to one when one or more inputs equals one. That means when none of the four is asserted, all four are inactive, then the third bit V should account for that condition. If V is zero, that means if the valid bit indicator is zero, we understand that at this point of time, none of the four is active. Okay, right? And if V is found to be one, we understand that. What do you understand? V is one means one or more inputs will be active. Remember, not only one, but it can also be the case that all four are active, or all n minus one inputs are active, or all n minus two, or only one, or two, or three, anything. So whenever V is one, we understand that at least one of the inputs is active. And if V is zero, we understand that all inputs are inactive. Okay, that is the situation. So that is the importance of V. Now let me ask you one question. Why do you think V should be important? Why do we need V? Even if V was not there, what would have been the problem? That is something we have discussed in the earlier class. You remember that from the smallest order module, we can get to the higher order module. Say from four input priority, we want to get an eight input priority. So we shall use multiple instances of four input priority encoder to get an eight input priority. So then V can be important. So it can play the role of an enable input or cascading input. Okay, we shall see a practical circuit. Don't worry. So when all inputs are zero, V equal to zero if there is no valid input. Okay, so if when V equal to zero, the outputs A and B are not inspected, because we understand that it is of no importance because none of the outputs, so they are put as don't care, right? Because our job is to simplify the design for all the output functions. There are three output functions. See, this is also a design task. What do you mean by a design task? I am giving you the specification. You have to implement the circuit. That is the job. Okay. So the design specification is given in the form of a truth table. And based on the truth table, you have to find out the circuit requirement to implement A, to implement B, and to implement V. So there are three Boolean functions. Each of the Boolean function is a four variable Boolean function. And we need to implement or realize the three Boolean output functions. Clear? Now, as per the truth table, higher subscript number gives higher priority. Higher subscript number gives higher priority of the input. So D3 is having the highest priority, right? So when D3 equal to, when D3 is 1, and this is not 1, I have written it wrong, I'm sorry for that. So when D3 is asserted, regardless of D2, D1, D0, whatever, they can be 0 or 1, forget about that. The output AB should be 1, 1. That is brought out by this fifth row. Look at the fact, when D3 is 1, I have written D0, D1, D2, in their case X, don't care. That means when D3 is 1, this is of paramount importance. I'll put AB equal to 1. I'm forgetful about the condition of D0. I don't care whether D0 is 1 or 0, whether D1 is 1 or 0, whether D2 is 1 or 0. Okay. So in the Boolean, in the four variable K map, this will correspond to how many cells? You can put them X to be 0 and then 1. That means 3, 2 to the power 3 or 8. So this actually takes care of no less than 8 number of Carnot map cells or squares, right? That we get by putting XXX to be, don't care. So if you see for A, where lies the 1? I mean, 1 will happen when regardless of the value of D0, D1, 2. So D0, D1, 2, whether they are 0 or 1, it is of importance that D1 should be 1, okay? So that means we get the midterm also here. Now coming to the midterm later. So that means when D3 equal to logic 1, regardless of the values of other inputs, AB should be 1, 1. Okay, this is wrong actually. When D3 equal to 1, not 1, 1, because D3 is a single Boolean variable. So I have written it wrongly. So when D3 equal to logic 1, regardless of the values of the other inputs, namely D0, D1, and D2, AB the output should be 1, 1. So from the truth table, I can get it right. Say, look at the fourth condition. Look at the last two rows. So A equals D3 is 2 regardless of the other, so I write D3. Then if D3 is low and D2 is high, so D3 odd with D3 bar D2. And this I can simplify using the absorption theorem. That means A odd with A bar B equals A odd with B, right? So here A equal to D3 and B equal to D2. So A D3 odd with D3 bar D2 will lend itself to D3 odd D2. So this, from three literals, I get a two literal. So this is a simplification, clear? Now look at B. I have to take care of the fifth row and the third row, okay? So what does the fifth row gives me? As there are don't cares, I can directly write as D3, clear? So D3 odd with, I look at the third row. Here, distinct output values are there, so I have to take that into account. That means either D3 or D3 becoming 0 and D2 becoming 0 and D1 becoming 1, that will lend me to B. So D3 odd with D3 bar and it with D2 bar and it with D1 bar. So again here also, by applying the same principle, namely A odd with A bar B will give me A odd B. So here B stands for the AND product D2 bar D1. So I write it as D3 odd with D2 bar D1. So from four literals, I get three literals. What about V? That I can simply see is that V is zero only when all of them are zero. And at least one of them becoming one, the V becoming one. So V is nothing but the logical sum of D3, D2, D1, and D0. Okay, so this is a simple logic diagram I get directly from the truth table. Now for more formal treatment, you may be asked that what are the mean terms for the two functions, AB? Now mean terms, you understand that it is a, in terms of D0, D1, D2, D3, where D0 is having the most significant bit, D3 is the least significant. So order of variable will matter when you write the mean terms. So when I write 1, I mean that D0 equal to 0, D1 equal to 0, D2 equal to 0, and D3 equal to 1, right? That's right. When I give, it is a M2, small m means mean term. So M2 means D2 equal to 1, D3 equal to 0, but the others are 0, like that. So here I find that the mean terms I can get in this form. By how do I get it? thing is that I can write once 000, then 100, then like that, 110, something like that. So I get minterm 1, minterm 2 I get from here, okay, 0010, then minterm 3, 0011, minterm 5, 0101, like that. So I get so many minterms, right, by expanding the fourth row and the fifth row, by replacing the x first by 0 and then by 1. Similarly, b, how do I get? By expanding the third row and the fifth row, by replacing the x by 0 once and then by 1. So by expanding the third row and the fifth row, I get so many minterms. Clear? So this is, the canonical sum of the minterms. So that's how I get a. But here, this is, you get it from the Carnot map, or you can directly get it from the inspection of the truth table. So no harm in that. So either way, you can do it. So this is about a four input priority encoder. Now we are coming, we are approaching the more and more practical circuit. Practical circuit in the sense that it is never the case that only one will be allowed to make its presence felt. It may be that multiple inputs can make its presence felt, but the system will honor, will give priority to only one input. Even though the more than one inputs can assert themselves, but the output code that will be resulting will be the one having the highest priority at the particular instant. This is the question of, this is the case of fixed priority. Okay. Now, decimal to BCD priority encoder. Now, you be careful. That means it produces a BCD output corresponding to the highest order decimal digit appearing on the inputs and ignores all others, even though they have made their presence felt, even though they have asserted themselves. So priority detection logic, what does it do? What is its job? It should be designed in such a manner that it must prevent a lower order digit input from disrupting the encoding of the higher. What do you mean by that? You see that, suppose between D7 and D5, D7 is having the highest priority. Now simultaneously D7 is high, D5 is high. Then the output code A3, A2, A1, A0 should be such that it will correspond to the code corresponding to D7, not D5. Or suppose all 7 inputs starting from D1 to D7 are asserted. Then also the output that will be resulting will be the input, will be the encoding, will be the code corresponding to D7, but for no others, which are having the lower priority. Okay. So for normal decimal to BCD encoder, remember that this we wrote earlier because we have done the decimal to priority encoder, if you have seen, if you have noted. So yeah, decimal to BCD encoder, when you have done, A0, you see that it is normally the Boolean order of D1, D3, D5, D7, D9. But now, when we are writing the equation for decimal to BCD, just we have inserted priority, now it will be a bit more complex. That means all A3, A2, A1, A0, it has been the Boolean sum of single variables. Now it will be not so simple, but a bit complicated. And how complicated? For that, we have to understand the logic. So logic is what? That means in the priority encoder, D1 will be allowed to activate the A0. See, when D1 is active, A0 becomes 1. When D3 is active, 0. Now, here, compared to D1, there can be higher order variables which do not influence A0. What are they? Say D2 or D4 or D6 or D8, right? So D2, D4, D6, D8 all have got higher priority than D1, but it does not influence. So in the logic equation for A0, D1 will be given importance provided D2, D4, D6, D8 are silent. Silent means if D2 is low and D4 is low and D6 is low and D8. So read the language in the priority encoder. D1, please, all of you, please read the language. If you understand the language, next you can immediately write the Boolean equation and subsequently you can draw the circuit diagram. But you should learn, you should understand the language very clearly for any problem of digital electronics. It is based on the logic. Okay. So in the priority encoder, D1 will be allowed to activate the A0. A0 is the output. A0 is activated by the one of these 5 inputs. So D1 will be allowed to activate the A0 output if and only if the number of if and only no higher order digits other than those that also activate A0. So what are they? Who are they? If no higher order digits, higher order means higher order than D1. Those are D2, higher order digits other than those that also activate. Other than those means, see, D3, D5, D7, these four are also higher order and they also activate A0. But D2, D4, D6 and D8, they are having higher order than D1, but they do not activate A0. Clear? So they should be silent. Okay. That means they should be low. In a priority encoder, D1 will be allowed to activate the A0 output if and only if no higher order digits other than those that also activate A0 are high. Okay. So that is D2, D4, D6 and D8 who are having higher order than D1, but they don't activate, so they should be silent. That's why in place of D1, I have to write this five input, five, that means a AND product of five. Here it was a simple Boolean variable. Okay. Next you see D3 activates A0. Again, there are higher order than D3 which do not activate A0, like D4, D6, D8. These three having higher order than D3, but they do not activate. So they should be silent. Okay. They should not be allowed to disrupt the logic condition. So not only D3 should be high, but at the same point of time, D4 should be disallowed. Not disallowed. D4 are silent, D6 is silent, D8. That means they are not active. If they are active, then what will be happen? D3's code will not be activated, will not be sent out to the output. You understand, is it not? Similarly, you see that D5 does activate A0, but there exist inputs having higher order than D5, namely D6 and D8, which do not activate A0. So only if D6 and D8 are silent, that means D6 and D8 are not active, and D5 is active, then only D5's code will go to the output. Suppose D6 is active or D8 is active, then the output code that will result will never be same as D5. I hope you understand. Similarly, D7, there is a input of higher priority than D7, but which does not activate. Say for example, D8. D8 has got higher priority than D7, but D8 does not activate A0. So when D7 is active, it is necessary that D8 should be inactive. Then only the code that will result will correspond to A0. But suppose D7 and D8 both are active, then the output code will not correspond to D7. Why? Because D8 is having higher priority. So if D9 is low or inactive, then the ultimate code will correspond to D8, not D7. I hope you understand it. Similarly, A1 will be high when D2, D3, D6 or D7 is high. That is for normal encoder, mind you, which we have seen earlier, not a priority encoder. So in the priority encoder, which we are studying at present, D2 will be allowed to activate the A1. Okay, if and only no higher order digits other than those that activate A1 are high. So what we want to say, in the case of normal normal encoder, A1 is the Boolean sum of D2, D3, D6, D7. Here you see that apart from D2, there are other higher order inputs which do not activate. Who are they? In between, say D4, D5, then D8. So D4, D5, D8 and D9 are the four inputs which are having higher priority than D2, but they do not activate A1. So they should be silent in order that D2 is active. That's why we bring in the complex input condition in place of only D2. Similarly, D3, say D4, D5, D8, D9, they do not influence A1, but they are having higher priority than D3. So only when they are silent or inactive, then if D3 is active, then D3 will get its code in the output. Clear? Similarly, D6. Compared to D6, there are other higher priority inputs like D8 and D9, which do not activate A1, but they have higher priority than D6. So when D6 is true, it is necessary, then D8 and D9 should be inactive. Otherwise, what will happen? This code will not correspond to D6. They may correspond to either D7 or D8 or D9, depending on who is active. And finally, D7. Compared to D7, D8, D9 have got higher priority, but they do not activate D1, so they should be silent. Next, you see A2. Any question? So A2 is high, this is the condition for normal encoder. Let me show you. Yeah. So in the normal case, A2 depends directly on D4, D5, D6, D7. But now when you now D4 or D5 or D6 or D7, but you have to take care of the higher priority inputs. So D8 and D9, they do not influence D2. D5, D6, D7, do. So D8 and D9 should be silent. Then only if D4 is asserted, its code may get over. Even we have to deal with D5 also. So if D5 is active, it is necessary that D8 and D9 are inactive. Similarly for D7, similarly for D7. Because D4, D5 come one after another. So the coefficients D8 bar, D9 bar is same for all the four subterms. Finally, A3 is high if D8 is high or D9. Now, A8 and A9, these are, if you write, see, for completeness sake, A3 should be written as A8, A9 bar. But from Boolean simplification, see, even if I write A8 for the sake of completeness, A8 ended with A9 bar or with A9. So A or with A bar B means A or with B. So even for correct logic, A9 bar would have been there, but we have simplified it, right? So we write it A8 or A9. So now I believe we can draw the circuit. There is no need. Now, you see, here we have dealt with, mind you, the circuit that we shall draw will correspond to what? Active low input, active low output. Here, the logic that we have written correspond to active high. Okay. Now, here the truth table that we shall write, mind you, let me arrest your attention. The truth table of the decimal to BCD priority encoder that you have written, the inputs and outputs are active low. You understand? I hope you all understand, but still I'll try to draw your attention and make everything clear. Inputs are outputs are active low. What it means? So if the inputs are at logic 1, it means that they are inactive. So in the very first row, you see D1 to D9, the 9 inputs are written as logic 1. It means that all of them are low. Then A3, A2, A1, A0 are also high. That means it corresponds to what? It corresponds to D0. Okay. Because actually, if outputs are active low, it means that in actuality it is 0, 0, 0, 0. And 0, 0, 0, 0 corresponds to the code of D1. Okay. Here you see D9 has got the highest priority. Okay. So that is 0. Then we can be oblivious of the input status of the remaining inputs. That means when D9 is 0, regardless of the input values associated with D1 to D8, the code that we'll write will correspond to D9. Clear? Now D9, 9 means what? 1, 0, 0, 1. That we would have written if the outputs are active high. But now we say that the truth table will correspond to output being active low, also input being active low. So when D9 is 0, we understand that D9 is active. So output that we shall write will be the not 1001, but the bitwise it will be complemented. So 0110, this will be the code for D9. Sure. Next, you see, look at the third row. D9 is 1, 1 means that D9 is inactive. D8 is 0 means DYT is, D8 is active. And what about the remaining 7? We don't care. Regardless of the values associated with D1 to D7, if D1 is 1 and D8 is 0, we understand that D8 is active, D9 is inactive. So then it is 0, 1, 1, 1. What do you mean? D8, you see that 8 in active high output, it should have been 1, 0, 0, 0. But no, the outputs correspond to active low. That means instead of writing 1, 0, 0, 0, we bitwise complement it. That means it becomes 0, 1, 1, 1. A3 is having the MSB, this is the A0 is the LSB, right? So it will be complemented bitwise. Next, you see, look at the fourth row. What does it mean? Achha, all of you are following. Is any doubt? All of you, let me once again tell you about the fourth row. What does it mean? It means that D9 and D8 are one. That means they are inactive. They are not asserting their presence fed. But D7 is zero. What does it mean? That of the three inputs, at least we can say, of the three inputs, D9, D8, D7, of which D9 has got the highest priority, D8 has the lower priority, D7 even lower priority, and D1 having the least priority. Okay, that is the situation. So D9 and D8, one means that D9 is inactive as well as D8, but D7 is active. And we don't care, regardless of the activity of the others. They may be inactive or they may be inactive. Doesn't matter. But the fact remains that D7, of all the possible inputs, D7 has the highest priority. So D7, it is active. Then the code will correspond to D7. And we would have written 0 followed by 111 for active high output. But as it is active low, so we write it as 1000. Clear? Again, look at this. It means that D7, D8, D9 are inactive. D6 is active. The remaining ones, what are they? We do not care. So the code will correspond to D6. And we would have written 0110, but as it is active low output, so we write it 1001. Clear? Do you have got any doubt? Achha, finally, you see that in the bottommost row, only D1 is active. The others are inactive. So it means 1110. 1110, what does it mean? Had it been active high output, we would have written 0001. But since it is active low output, we write 1110. So what I have written, magnitudes of the decimal inputs determine their priorities. Okay. If any decimal input is active, it is encoded if all higher value inputs are inactive. Please read carefully. If any decimal input is inactive, then okay. Now, next question, how to draw the circuit? Can you tell me? I want the circuit of this, the specified truth table. All of you are listening? Hello? I want a circuit. How will I get the circuit?
NAND gate, I suppose.
Okay, let me talk about the circuit now. See, here, this is the Boolean conditions that you have written correspond to active high input, active high output. So here I require a 2 input OR gate. Here I require a 4 input OR gate, and then 3 number of 3 input AND gates, all these things. But now, in order to reflect this truth table, it will not be OR gate. It will be NOR gate. Good. Not NAND. It is a converse of OR means NOR gate. And also the inputs, you see that. All of you, please just pay brief attention. It will end the class shortly. Input should be active low, output should be active low. For outputs to be active low, the OR gates will be replaced by NOR gates. Remember that when we studied about the decoder, why are you forgetting? When we studied about decoder, if you remember, for active high output, we required AND gate. For active low output, we required NAND gate. Here, for active high output, we require OR gate. For active low, we'll require NOR gate. I'll prove that also. And also, as the inputs are active in active low, in addition, so each of the input will be complemented prior to being fed into the AND gate. I'll show you. Just I'll show. See, as both inputs and outputs are active low, final circuit is obtained by inverting all inputs because the inputs are active low and replacing the OR gates as implied by 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, what do you mean by these equations 1, 2, 3, 4? We mean this 1, 2, 3, 4, these equations I've written because these are the four output equations. So 1, 2, 3, 4 means corresponding to A0, A1, A2, A3. Fine. So, replacing the OR gates as implied by equations 1, 2, 3, 4 in the previous page by OR gates. For example, consider A3 for the most significant bit. A3 equals D8 OR with D9. So that is a two input OR gate. In place of that, we'll get a two input OR gate. And D8 and D9 will individually complement it. Then we'll get this circuit. This will realize this output column. Let me prove also. Verify that for each of the 10 rows, here there are 10 rows, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Verify that for each of the 10 rows, the output column values for A3 are realized. How? Just look at this. Here you have got 0 in 2 rows. The remaining ones, these are 1. And for a NOR gate, when you get, say, a multiple input NOR gate is there, so at least one of them being logic 1, what will be the output for NOR gate? Output will be 0, is it not? For a multiple input OR gate, you get the, for a multiple input NOR gate, the output is logic 1 only when all of the inputs are individually 0. Clear? But for a multiple input NOR gate, if at least one of the inputs is at logic 1, then you get the output to be 0. And look at the second and third row. Here, the output A3 is 0 when D9 is 0 or D8 is 0. In the rest of the conditions, it is plain and simple 1. So that's why. If D8 is 0 or D9 is 0, what happens? You see that? If D8 is 0, the output of this inverter being 1, that is fed, this will result in 0. Again, if D9 is 0, as per say second row, if D9 is 0, then output of the inverter is 1, and that is fed as input to the NOR gate, and the output will result to be 0. Right? But all the remaining conditions, you see, for all the remaining conditions, D8, D9 are both 1. First row, D8, D9 both 1. So here, D8 and D9 are both 1. That means the both the inputs of the two input NOR gate will be 0. So if both the inputs of the two input NOR gate is 0, what do we get as the output? What do we get as the output? Anyone? Are you present? So you get logic 1. Okay, clear? All of you can understand? Please respond. So are you convinced that A3 will be realized by this circuit? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah. And lastly, I'll show you for A2. Because A2 is a bit complicated, right? A2, you see, just I draw your attention. A2 here, you see, you require a 4-input OR gate, right? And you require a, sorry, where is it? Here. This equation 3. A2, for implementing A2, remember this is the equation for active high input, active low input. The same equation you can make for active low input, active high input, only replace the OR gate by NOR gate and individually complement the input, nothing else. I'm also trying to prove why this is so. So here you require a 4-input OR gate and you require 4 number of 3-input AND gates. So here you see. One part is that, so I have written the complete equation. A2 equal to AND product of D4, D8 bar, D9 bar, and I just take care of this. Similar circuit will result for that. I have not drawn the entire circuit because it will make the circuit very cumbersome. You can draw it in your. So here you see, for D7, AND with D8 bar, AND with D9 bar, what I write, all that variables are individually complemented. Then here D8 is complemented, D9 is complemented. So it's two additional inverter. And then it's input AND gate. And that is being fed as a input to 4-input. In the equation, it says a 4-input OR gate, but as it is active low output, so I replace the OR gate by NAND. NOR. Now you see that corresponding to D7, D8, D9 bar, how A2 is realized to be in that case. So D7 is high, D8 bar, D9 bar are low. So here you see, say for example, D7, D8 and D9. So D7, D8 bar, D9 bar. Say for example, it becomes 0 only in this case, right? Say when D7 is low, then output A2 should be low. Look at that. If D7 is low, then what is the output? So it becomes 1. Okay. And what about the remaining 3 inputs? D8 and D9. So D8 and D9 are what? They are also 1 corresponding to this. Sorry. So D7, just look at this. Look at the this fourth row, where D7 is false. Sorry, D7 is low. D8 and D9 are high. So if D7 is low, just consider this. D7 is low. D8 and D9 are high. Sorry, D7 is low. So here low, it becomes 1. And D8 and D9 are high, so 1. So after two inverters, it becomes 1. So 1, 1, 1, this is high. And that is fed as a input to a 4-input NOR gate. So it becomes 0. Similarly, you can see it here also, D6, right? But for D6, you require another circuit. So here D6 is there. You have to draw another 3-input OR gate. Okay, just replace D7 by D6, you will get it. Okay, similarly for D5, D8, D9 will be common. Just replace this D7 by D5. So you will get another third gate. And for this only replace D7 by D4, you get it. That means similarly, is a similar structure will be there at the inputs of the three other AND gates. So this circuit structure will realize the column A2. Similarly, you can draw it for column A1, column A0. Only remember that for active low output, the OR gate will be replaced by NOR gate. And for active low input, the you require a separate inverter. Okay. I hope it is clear. No, any doubt? Okay, dear friends. So I think we have to break now, nah? Because we have to wait for lunch. So if any doubt is there, let me know. We can clarify. All of you, any doubt? Dear friends?
Sir, I had something to ask regarding the class.